So my talk is about the technique which we invented with Maxim for the purposes of wall crossing formulas, and today I will explain how it could be related to the subject of resurgence. So I start with motivations and its wall crossing formulas, subject which was popular like 10 years ago. Let me start with an example. Consider the algebra of formal power series of two variables. If you don't like rational numbers, you can replace them by complex numbers. It doesn't matter. And let's handle it with the Poisson bracket. For a pair of non-negative integers, a and b, satisfying this condition, let's define the automorphism of this algebra, b, which preserves the Poisson bracket and which maps a pair xy in the following expression. All right, so then the claim, which can be checked directly, is that these automorphisms satisfy the following formula, which is essentially equivalent to the five-term identity for the logarithm function. All right, so this is the simplest example of the wall crossing formula. And in the paper with Maxim in the archive, we proposed a big class of wall crossing formulas for which this one is just the simplest possible example. Even here, we can introduce a number k in the Poisson bracket. So this is case k equal 1. And then define a collection of Poisson automorphisms of this algebra and with this bracket. The difference is that you put k here in the power, and these automorphisms, Poisson automorphisms, they satisfy more complicated identities. Wall crossing formulas, where in the left-hand side you can still multiply two basic things, but the right-hand side will be more complicated, sometimes infinite. It will be an infinite product of these automorphisms raised in some integer power. So here, product of this raised in integer powers. So these wall crossing formula, they were invented for a purpose. So they appear in mathematics in the theory of Donaldson-Thomas invariants. say, of three-dimensional Calabi-Yau categories, for example, Calabi-Yau three-folds, and these integer powers, they are these dt invariants. In physics, the same numbers, and essentially for a closely related reason, appeared in the four-dimensional n equal to gauge theories. And basically, this is a development of the last like 10, 15 years at most. But this simplest formula, five-term identity, it appears long before this relatively recent development. It appeared, it can be found, in the paper by Dillinger, Delabere, and Pham, 1993, the Varos resurgence for the operator which appeared in the previous talk and in many other talks. It's a Schrödinger operator with a small parameter, and v of x is a polynomial. So it seems to be a completely different topic at the first glance. So the question is, what is the underlying mathematical structure which naturally appears in both in this wall crossing story and in the resurgence of the Schrödinger operator. And so that's a structure which we proposed in that paper with Maxim, and that's the one which I remind you as a motivation. So underlying structure the one which we called stability data on graded Lie algebras. So by the way, it also underlies these wall crossings which appear in implicitly in Maxim's talk on exponential integrals, and I will comment later on that. So what are the data? So I'm a mathematician, so I would like to give definitions and state results precisely. So what are the data? So free abelian group gamma. So in physics it's called charge lattice. Gamma graded Lie algebra. Say over rationals. So any field of characteristic zero. So in the condition gamma graded means this homomorphism of abelian groups . So the notation is chosen in such a way that physicists translate immediately. So this is a central charge. And a collection of elements should be noted A of gamma. So graded component, which basically in a sense, these are Donaldson-Thomas invariants or BPS invariants up to something which some transformation which I explain later on. So these are the data, so four types of data, and there is just one axiom which we call support property. So that's an axiom on this data. So basically, this means that if we consider the support of this collection, set of all gammas for which A of gamma is non-zero, then this support is separated from a kernel of the central charge. Better. All right. So it can be formulated as an existence of certain quadratic form, which is negative on the kernel and positive on the support. So this is a non-trivial part which one should always check in concrete examples. So this axiom, it allows to define certain, if you like, certain pronilpotent group. More precisely, for every array on the plane, so it's a corollary of this support property, if you like. So for every array with a vertex in the origin, one can give a meaning of the following expression. So one can take exponent overall of the sum overall A of gamma with the condition that the central charge belongs to L. And moreover, from this property, one can deduce that these gammas belong to a certain convex cone, C of L, which belongs to gamma. So this can be thought as the rays for which this A of L is non-trivial can be treated as kind of analogs of, if you'd like, subgroups in some big, possibly infinite dimensional group. In particular, if we take a bigger sector, but which has to be strict, which means less than 180 degrees, it can contain many rays, like countably many rays for which A of L is non-trivial, and so we can define the corresponding group element, which is a product, say in the clockwise direction, of these simplest inputs. All right. So this is the axiomatics. On the set of this stability data, there is a certain topology which basically means that if we have a continuous path in the space of central charges, which is entirely linear algebra data, then it can be lifted to the continuous path in the space of all stability data, in particular involving this A of gamma, which in general they kind of behave in the locally constant way. So in many examples, in practice, we have not just the lattice, this lattice gamma, but we also have an integer valued skew symmetric form. It can be symplectic or not. And so if this additional piece of data is given, then we can consider the algebra of functions on the corresponding torus. This is a torus, so you can consider a torus of characters. It's a matter of choice. GM, okay, let me replace. So it's some of these are physicists, so okay, it's C star. So this is a Lie algebra, because this is a okay, I can take dual. So again, either of these, yeah, all right. So anyway, so this is a torus. It's a Poisson torus. So therefore, there is a bracket, and in fact, if we treat it not as an algebra, but just as a Lie algebra, so it's a direct sum of one-dimensional vector spaces, so graded components are one-dimensional, and so this, if you want to, on this, let's call it torus Lie algebra. If we want to end it with a stability data, so this A of gamma will be just numbers. So then the
integer numbers?
No. In general, no. So I put it C, I can of course put return to GM. So at best I can kind of assume that these are rational, but I will tell you in a minute what one should do in order to make them integers. All right, now returning to this example of Schrödinger operator, so how to see this data? So we have the spectral curve. Which is hyperelliptic in this case. So it projects 2 to 1 to the projective line, and there are ramification points, and there is also a singularity at infinity, essential singularity. So let's take gamma to be the relative first homology. This is the set of all these ramification points and infinity. So there is a Poisson pairing. Inside, sigma is this, S is the ramification points and infinity. It's all.
No, I think the just homology of open curve has already Poisson pairing.
Yeah, it will have, so no.
The first homology.
Yeah, it's the first homology, all right. You're right, yeah, okay. But then I need to take the dual one, yeah, which is the first homology of the open curve, and the central charge will be just a period map. Now, in this example, so this is gamma, there is a natural Poisson pairing, and so then the analog of this, it's a map T of gamma, which maps which maps the generator inter inter So this is an example of Poisson cluster transformation of Fock and Goncharov. And you can put here instead of minus, you can put Z2-valued cosycode in general. I mean, if you want to generalize Z2-valued one cosycode. Sigma lambda mu. All right. Now, returning to Stavros' question. So at best, we can hope that A of gamma are integers, are rationals. But if you have a skew symmetric form, then it turns out that the Möbius transform, or inverse Möbius transform of A of gamma tends to be integer. So if we write A of gamma in this way, then so these are BPS invariants in physics. All right, so then the wall crossing formulas, which are basically just a direct corollary of the definition of the topology on the space of stability data. So it's a certain wall crossing formulas. These are identities. Between T of gamma raised in these integer powers. So then in the example in this five term identity, this omega of gamma equal to one. Now the term wall crossing formula, just for those who I've never seen it before. So the origin is the following. If you consider the space of central charges, it's a vector space. And in the space of central charges, there are real codimension one walls where this omega of gamma jumps. So omega of gamma, in fact, it depends on the central charge. And so if you have on one side of the wall, if you have some collection of omega of gamma, so they are locally constant if a set of walls is not dense subset. So when we cross the wall, we apply the wall crossing formula and can calculate these numbers on the other side of the wall if we start it somewhere and move in the space of central charges.
And Z vanishes on the wall?
No. Okay, thank you. Yeah, I should say what are these walls. So the walls, generic walls, they are defined in the following way. You look in the lattice, you look for central charges which do the following. There is a lattice of rank 2, like two z-independent vectors, which central charge is mapped to the line. So there are lattices which are collapsed. So then the central charges are proportional. All right. Now, if we return to this example of Schrödinger operator, which I use as a motivation for this wall crossing story. So in that example, we have five term identity, omega of gamma equal to zero. So of course, like Schrödinger operator, it's the same as H connection of rank 2 SL2 connection. So what we have, like, say SL2 connection curve can be in fact any. So then in the Durham picture we have an affine line in the space of connections, and the monodromy data Riemann-Hilbert correspondence monodromy converts it into analytic path.
Is AX
meromorphic or AFX can be meromorphic, it can have poles. It's, So it and if I use the notation for the generators of this torus Lie algebra, so when I have analytic path, I'm interested only in the germ of this path as h goes to infinity. So, and in the terminology of this of 90s, so this E gamma of h is called Varros symbol. Well, crossing formulas, actually, they ensure that you can glue global solutions from local WKB solutions. There is also Varros coefficient. Well, and the theorem of Ecal that these Varros coefficients, they are resurgent. So. And resurgent in H. And moreover, Ecal introduced a notion which is called direction of singularities. Direction of singularities, which you can easily guess where it is. And so this direction of singularities are rays through, in my notation, through V of gamma. Now, Varros coefficients, they are transformed slightly differently, but it's a direct consequence of. So I put here plus or minus because I can, as I said, I can introduce Svanka cycle. So here, let me put omega of gamma, this is omega of gamma. So, and Varros symbols, they are transformed as cluster coordinates. And so then you can interpret, if you'd like, this observation that in the space of framed local systems, which is a cluster variety, you have an analytic path near infinity. And so then, in a sense, this appearance of H and all this resurgence, it's auxiliary to the fact that there are cluster coordinates in the space of framed local systems. Okay, now, this subject of 90s about Varros resurgence, it received some kind of a boost after this wall crossing story, and there are kind of papers devoted to the study of Varro's resurgence in kind of in more complicated geometries. So I can mention a paper by Iwaki and Nakanishi a few years ago. It's everything is in archive, and even today you see it non-stopping story. Even today there is a paper by Hollands and Neitzke exactly on the same topic, where they generalized the second order Schrödinger operator story to higher order, including operas. Okay, now in this story still omega of gamma, this BPS invariants, they are equal to one, although the wall crossing formulas can be more complicated, they more than just five term identity. But you can, since as you see, this all about the geometry of the space of local systems, so you can ask other questions, in particular this now well-known, famous paper by Gajota, Moore and Neitzke, in fact several papers. They wanted to construct hyper-Keller metric on the space of local systems. So it's a different problem, but still very interesting. And it's, it involves the same geometry. It involves the geometry of the spectral curve and triangulations with vertices at ramification points. So in that story, we see more complicated wall crossing formulas. With non-trivial omega of gamma, not necessarily equal to one. In fact, the geometric meaning of this omega of gamma is a virtual number of geodesics on the spectral curve with a given homology class. So it's another repeatable problem in geometry. Now, so in these examples, the Lie algebra is infinite dimensional. Yeah? It's a Lie algebra of functions on the torus, say on the Poisson torus, endowed with a natural bracket. Now in Maxim Stock, different type of wall crossing formulas appeared. He didn't write them, but or maybe he did, I don't remember. Oh no, he did. So he studied exponential integrals, say in finite dimension, and here some volume form. So here the graded Lie algebra is just GLN, where N is so gamma here, if you remember, it's middle cohomology or middle homology of the space, so all this in some big space with respect to some boundary at infinity with integer coefficients. So this is GLN, and the gradient is just by the root. So gamma belongs to the root lattice. So the wall crossing formulas here are more simple. They are so-called Chakotay-Wafa wall crossing formulas. So from physics perspective, this is a two-dimensional massive theory, supersymmetric, and this is four-dimensional. But as I explain later, you can combine both things and still have a geometric meaning. Now, if you have a stability data, I erased the definition, but there is a central charge, and you can always introduce a small parameter by rescaling the central charge. So in particular, in this matrix integrals, in this exponential integral story, you have a collection of critical values of the function S, and so then this rescaled central charge is this one. So then the walls here, the walls which Thibault asked, it's the space, the central charge basically is given by the collection of these complex numbers, and so the wall is a collection of complex numbers where three of them belong to the same real line. Yes, it's complex, yeah. And actually, yeah, so then you can just having a fixed stability data, fixed central charge, you can kind of rotate this H, change the argument, and so you see some interesting events. Okay.
Is it possible to talk about the status? I mean, there's this sort of conjectural hypercalometric. I mean, has that been proved now?
No, it's not proved. So the thing is that kind of they have some integral equation, this generalized thermodynamical beta, which depends on the additional parameter, additional positive parameter, some radius.
So have they proved that these functions do give the clutching match for a twister space or not?
No. You want me? I can give a talk on the work of Gyota Muravinsky, but it will be a different talk. But roughly speaking, kind of, if you start with a Dalbosto, if you can start with a wrong complex structure, yeah, with the one which is Hitchin system, so you have a foliation by a billion varieties. So you can try to construct, first you construct the naive metric, yeah, which is semi-flat. Then you add these instanton corrections, which basically correspond to, you consider kind of, geometrically, they appear when you have pseudo-holomorphic disk with a boundary on some, in this case, on the geodesic for the quadratic differential. So then you have some integral equation, you want to solve it kind of by iteration. So the question is whether the solution exists. So they proved that the solution exists as a series over a small parameter, which is this R, which okay. So then in a sense it's a non-Archimedean hypercalor metric, yeah. But they didn't prove that it converges.
Is that not the only possible sort of geometric interpretations of what these Poisson orthomorphisms actually are though? I mean, is there a different geometric interpretation?
No. I'm not sure that it's a question about geometry. It's a question you do iteration, so your integral equation. The answer is written as an infinite sum over some planar trees, and so.
Right. I mean, the question is more: is there a different geometric interpretation apart from that? If we did want to understand geometrically what the functions actually are.
No, I think it's just a technical problem of proving some estimates, and actually, it's a very good kind of a point, because I am coming to these estimates which are not available in the case of Gyota Muravinsky. It's a special class of stability data, or more generally, actually, later with Maxim we introduced the notion of wall crossing structure, which serves also complex integrable systems, like Hitchin system, for which the lattice and the Lie algebra, they can depend on some base. They form a local system. But anyway, so exponential stability data and this is a class of stability data which as we expect is related to resurgence. I will formulate a conjecture later. So then the setup it's a graded Lie algebra and assume that it end out with a norm. So like every graded component carries a norm, say Banach norm definition. So suppose that this norm graded Lie algebra is endowed with a stability data in a sense which unfortunately I erased, but hopefully you remember. So it's central charge, a collection of elements A of gamma, all these blah blah blah, satisfying the support property. So we say that stability data are of exponential type if there exist positive constants such that we have this exponential estimate for BPS invariants, for Donaldson Thomas invariants depending on who you are, physicist or mathematician. All right. So this is a definition. And so there are several geometrically defined stability data which we expect to be exponential. So if you'd like examples. So first, suppose X is a three-dimensional Calabi-Yau or complex numbers. So then the lattice is third homology or cohomology. It doesn't matter if you assume that it's compact. Let's assume that. So the bilinear form is a Poincaré pairing. And the central charge is the integral over holomorphic volume form. Check this on Calabi-Yau over three-dimensional cycles. So this is one example. And omega of gamma is decay invariants. So second is complexified Chern-Simons. It's kind of infinite dimensional type of example.
But you said you singled out some A gamma.
Example one. What are A gamma?
No, A gamma or omega of gamma, better. These are called decay invariants, like number of special Lagrangians in the given class in three-dimensional, like virtual number of special Lagrangian submanifolds in X with a given class. I think it's even not known whether every class can be realized by a special Lagrangian, but I mean, we are all optimistic, so then we hope that this is an example not only every realized, but also there is an exponential bound on these numbers omega. Because you can replace in that estimate A of gamma by omega gamma. So complexified Chern-Simons, but actually probably not holomorphic Chern-Simons. And the last example, complex integrable systems. Of Hitchin type. So for the discussion, how this omega of gamma appears naturally, I in the framework of complex integrable systems, I rather give you a reference to our paper in archive. All right.
Excuse me. So what is gamma in complexified Chern-Simons?
In complexified Chern-Simons, it is H3 of your three-dimensional real manifold. Well, it's Z, or it can be zero, yeah, theoretically. Yeah, but it's Z, yeah. If it's sphere, yeah.
No, not for holomorphic.
For holomorphic, actually, I don't know, because whether it's of exponential type, you have count the number of co-associative submanifolds. I have no idea whether there are results.
What is A of gamma? So given an integer gamma, what would be the A? Or omega of gamma that you're counting?
What will be the omega of gamma? What is it? Is it number of harmonic bundles, harmonic local systems on the three dimensions?
Some kind of like custom invariance, but for complex.
For complexified. Yeah.
Some
no, but it, yeah, but you if you want to compute it, kind of you can replace any complex representation by, I think you can by UN.
No.
No, you cannot. Yeah. You're right. Yeah. It's sort of a number in properly defined sense of representations in whatever. GLNC.
Where gamma is n?
Gamma is z.
Little gamma here is.
Yeah, it's just
n.
Integer. Yeah. All right. So good. Let me.
Not only does positive integers. What about negative?
Sometimes there can be no negative integers. Yeah, for example, if you consider representations of a quiver, your lattice is like Zn, dimension, whatever, dimensional lattice, but actually you see only non-negative gammas, you see the cone. All right. Now, how to approach resurgence? So the idea is to encode geometrically exponential stability data as construction of some complex analytic manifold, which is in fact an analytification of some formal scheme which exists always without any exponential bound. So let me kind of to be brief because I don't have too much time. So what's the idea? So suppose that you decompose a plane into the finite union of sectors such that every sector intersects only with the previous one and with the next one, no more. And then if we have this support property, so we can we can construct collection of strict convex cones in this vector space. Yeah. I don't know, can be rational. And if we cover the whole plane, so then we have a wheel of cones, what we call the wheel of cones. This kind of a picture. All right. So then the idea is actually it's very much similar to what appeared in Maxim's talk on exponential integrals, when you started with some trivial bundle over each sector Vi, and then you modified this trivial bundle with some wall crossing automorphism, so it becomes not necessarily non-trivial. And the main point was, okay, so let me do this. So in this case, it will be locally trivial bundle with the fiber, which is a torus. So let's consider first a small disk with the coordinate h bar. And if we look for the intersection of these two things, we have from general wall crossing formalism, we have automorphisms, which I denote by GI. And so I have a collection of automorphisms, GI, from the completed algebra of functions on this torus. If I choose a basis, maybe completed.
But what is gamma in this?
Ah, okay. Yeah, you're right. My all right. So gamma is something which is given, which I choose. It's part of the data. So my Lie algebra in this case is just the Lie algebra of, say, algebraic vector fields on this torus, which is graded, right? So then the map, this infinite dimensional group, it acts on the basis of monomials, and it acts in the following way. And if we impose the, if we assume that the stability data is exponential, then there is an exponential bound on the coefficients of this series, so they define analytic germ. And also, if you want, since I want to formulate a conjecture about resurgence of some series, so I can also assume that in each cone I have an estimate that the real part of Z of beta over H, when H is in the sector and beta is in the cone, that the real part is positive. Okay, so then we can use this, if you'd like, that one parameter group to twist these automorphisms in the same way as we went from Varros symbols to Varros coefficients. It's exactly the same procedure. So then we have maps for every sector. And so then we can use these automorphisms to glue trivial bundles with the fiber T over each sector into something new. Now, because of the exponential behavior, exponential decay of these factors, exactly the same as in Maxim's talk about exponential integrals, the Taylor series do not depend on the sector, and so then we get a bundle of the punctured, say, disk, which can be continued C infinity and therefore analytically to the center. And so then the conjecture is that this series, I mean, it's a general conjecture, you can check it in the examples, this series is resurgent. And the same is true if you take the logarithm of this. Okay, so I have...
assuming what? Because this goes...
assuming exponential bound.
It's not this series, but when you consider holomorphic sections...
Yeah, holomorphic section of the glued bundle, but if but these series, they are formal series.
Then you get formal series.
Yeah, which are resurgent. Yes, that's what I mean.
But the cones, we should, these cones associated to the sectors or what?
Yes, these cones are associated to the sector.
Anything.
It's not entirely anything, it's almost anything. There are some compatibility conditions with the central charge. So the central charge is a map from the vector space which contains these cones to R2. So if you consider the dual one, you have an embedding of R2 to this, so it should be kind of a slice section which contains, which sits inside, which kind of, I don't know, like imagine you have some pizza and you just push it in the center, so then the horizontal slice is the image of R2. It's a technical condition which I, as I said, I prefer not to be very technical. All right, so again, there are examples when we expect geometric examples when we expect that these conditions are satisfied. So we have resurgent series constructed just from the stability data.
Again, I think you forgot to mention that for exponential stability data, we expect that if you deform the central charge is still exponential.
I didn't forget. I simply I look at the time and I see, there are several. Okay, so since there are just basically 2 minutes left, so many things are expected. That if we deform the central charge, this exponential stability property is stable. Moreover, there are some other very interesting properties which you can define just working with stability data on gradedly algebras. For example, it was observed both in mathematics and physics, like for example in the work of Cardova, that generating series which appear in wall-crossing formula, they are algebraic, so they satisfy algebraic equations. So sometimes you can write down them, but we have a general proof of this algebraicity based on another property of this stability data, which we call algebraic stability data. So the point is that we have this kind of a basic block, which we called stability data on gradedly algebra, and then we can impose additional properties, and from this kind of geometry we can deduce analyticity, like in this case, or algebraicity, or maybe some deeper property of the series which used to glue the corresponding global object. For example, if you want to combine it with this GLN wall crossing with this, which appear in these exponential integrals, instead of gluing some complex analytic space using these automorphisms, where this is just an analytic path, similar to Varro's story, you build also a vector bundle over it. So then you have a mixture of two types of wall crossing formulas, which are known in physics as 2D, 4D wall crossing form. It's a mixture of Chakotay-Laffa and what we've done. So anyway, my time is up.
Would it be possible to write similar wall crossing formulas for more complicated polynomial Poisson structures?
You mean?
No. For example, if instead of xy you write some cubic polynomial, quadratic.
Homogeneous, but I don't know how to grade it.
It should be graded invariant under total sections.
It's not impossible, but I don't know how to do that.
So this series there that you said that is resurgent, I have two questions on it. First of all, is resurgent with respect to which?
Not this series, it's resurgent. It's kind of, this is misleading. This arrow, it's not this.
I was brief because it was in complete analogy with the story about Varro's coefficients.
In exponential terms in one over x bar and then z.
You can fix. You can put z equal to 1. It doesn't matter. It's the same story with Varro's. When you write down WKB expansion in the parameter h, there is also this parameter on the curve. So you can fix it and you still have resurgent.
Are there Hormat power series in H bar there in these conjectures that are expected to be resurgent in H bar?
Yes. You glue this thing some bundle, you consider the holomorphic section, and then expand to H bar, get Hormat power series in H bar.
Okay. So here it's not an expansion in H bar. But the point is that you glue, let me repeat again. So the logic is the same as with exponential integrals. You have a collection of sectors on the plane. So in each of these, you have some formal series. So you correct them. And then you glue some analytic vector bundle. But the expansion, this is H plane. Expansion at zero of the sections is the same. It does not depend on the sector. So this expansion in H is a resurgent series.
And how is this related to the standard Gromov-Witten generating functional or Donaldson-Thomas generating functional of Calabi-Yarros-Riffel?
If you have exponential estimate for the number of BPS states or Donaldson-Thomas invariants, then you have resurgence. You can insert exactly in the way which I just described. It's quite general. I even didn't use a Poisson structure there.
For closed Calabi-Yarros, not exponential.
No. For closed.
It's only for local Calabi-Yarros.
It's only for local. Yeah. Like for example, I don't know, conic bundle over spectral curve, something like that.
Let's thank you again.